G'day, Grimmers! Hello, hello from beautiful Tasmania on this not so chilly, but just wintry day in Tasmania. Thanks for hanging out with me. I'm just doing my usual Sunday meal prepping for the week because I work on Mondays and Tuesdays. I like to have food good to go. Funny enough, the three things we're making today, you could actually serve it as a dinner party if you wanted to. We're going to make a very quick and easy broccoli soup, which will look a little bit like this. I will show you how to make that tahini yogurt. Instead of just putting plain yogurt, I'll show you how to make a little tahini yogurt. I don't have microgreens, and I'm doing a simpler recipe because I couldn't find this particular recipe online, and it is a bit fancy pants, so I found another Donna Hay. And it's her super quick, super green soup, which I like the sound of. Get that one knocked over pretty quickly. We're also going to be making this monstrosity. It's a baked tomato meatloaf, and we're going to kick off with getting that on the go because that's going to take the longest. I'll be having this for dinner tonight with some mashed potato and green beans. Yummy, yummy. Let's get that recipe ready. How's everyone doing? They're silent lurker types today, which is fine. I don't mind. I just go live because I'm going to be cooking anyway. I might as well keep people company if they want to just hang out. And lastly, we're going to make this really easy chocolate mousse, which I will have for dinner tonight as well after my meatloaf. Yummy, but very easy recipe. Lots of chocolate mousse recipes floating around, but this one is so easy. Deb, hello. I wasn't expecting you to pop in. Hello, gorgeous. Much love to you. And what was I going to say? Something else. The links to the meatloaf recipe and the soup are in the description, and I'll also upload. I'll be cropping all these lives and doing little shorter videos and putting them on the Shitty Kitty Kitchen, but I'll show you how to make the tahini dressing. That'll be its own little video as well, and the chocolate mousse. I popped the ingredients up. There's only four, but I will write up the recipe as well. Hey, shady man, you woke up at stupid o'clock. Well, you might as well hang out here, right? But what I might do first, we're going to get this meatloaf for cranking because it will take a while to make it and assemble it and all of that sort of stuff. As always, none of these recipes are recipes I've made before. You are my guinea pigs. So the first thing we need to do is chop up some bacon, basically four rashers, but I'm just trimming a bit of the fat off them. I had a little bit of leftover bacon and I had a couple of rashers in the freezer, so it's all about, what I'm trying to do at the moment is I've just got a really full freezer. That meatloaf does look yum. Hopefully it tastes yum. I'm sure it will. But yeah, I've never made it before, so I can't vouch for its goodness. But being Donna Hay, I reckon it will be pretty awesome, as you would know, Deb. Pretty reliable, like we were just chatting about before I went live. Yeah, I'm trying to use up things in my freezer a bit too, so I'm sort of choosing, and pantry. So I'm choosing a lot of recipes that use up things I've already got in the house. So when I have to go shopping, I really only have to grab a couple of ingredients, you know, just the fresh stuff pretty much. I'm minimalizing everything in my house, and I want my pantry and my fridge to be like they were when we were in Vietnam. We pretty much bought the food we were going to eat that day, and that was about it. They don't have pantries full of, I mean, we had a big bag of rice, but you know, they don't have pantries full of food and spices and tin stuff and polenta and flowers. They literally buy what they need for the day, which you can do over there because life's a little bit cheaper there, but I am trying to use up a lot of stuff. Like, I know I've got some polenta, funnily enough, that I want to make something with soon. So yeah, rather than just finding new recipes and going out and grabbing a whole heap of new things, use up what you've got in your house, especially because food's getting so bloody expensive now. You might as well use and cook up what you've already got sitting around. So I'm just being a bit haphazard with my kitchen scissors and chopping up my bacon. What are you Groovers doing on your lovely Sunday or Saturday evening or Sunday early morning, wherever you be? So yeah, I'm never too precious with this sort of stuff. Like, I will chop them up a little bit smaller because it's quite a big meatloaf. It's got a kilo of mince. But that'll do, pig. next up, we are going to chop up an onion, carrot, and some garlic. Now, I'm actually going to use a Spanish onion, but you can use a normal brown onion. But I forgot to grab an extra onion. So I've got two onions in the house, a brown one and a Spanish, and or red, some people would call it. I decided I'd use the red one in the meatloaf because it's a tomato-based meatloaf. And use the brown one for the soup. Get a bit creative in the kitchen, you know. Necessity is the mother of invention. Use what you've got. I kind of like doing things a bit haphazard when I cook too, so you guys are like not too precious about having the exact ingredients. Like, we can always substitute. Get that little core bit out because that's never nice to chomp down on. Bit quiet on the YouTubes today. I'll be live for a couple of hours, so don't feel like you've got to hang around with me. I just figure I might as well go live and chatter away while I cook rather than sometimes I like cooking and putting on a cooking show. Just chop up your onion like that. I'm just going to put the heat on this frying pan because it does take a while to heat up. You're going to need quite a large pan because we're cooking a kilo of minced meat, ground beef as they say in the US of A, and you want it on a fairly high heat as well. We also need 4 cloves of garlic. You can do what I was showing you guys the other day, and buy little jars of garlic. If you don't cook a lot, don't buy a whole bulb of garlic because you'll use like 2 cloves and then it'll just sit and go dry. But I needed a lot of garlic for a few things I've made this week, so I bought fresh. But there's nothing wrong with the stuff in a jar. I've got this back down here. 4. Just get rid of the skin. We don't want that in the meatloaf. Not that you'd know. Compost. You have so much mince in your freezer because you buy every time you go to the supermarket. Yeah, look, I do buy my meats from the local butcher, but I had to go to Coles to get Sunny's stuff yesterday. Some of her stuff. And I did go via the meat section just to see if there are any deals. And a kilo of beef mince for $13 seemed like a good idea. So I grabbed it. The thing I love about meatloaves is, tonight I'm just going to be doing it sort of, you know, traditionally having a big chunk of it with the tomato sauce that it'll be cooking in and some mashed potato and beans. But meatloaf toasted sandwiches are also really yummy. Just slice it like a piece of bread and get a really nice chutney, although this won't need a chutney because again it's baking in a tomato sauce. But yeah, really nice toasted sandwiches, also yummy in a fresh bread sandwich too. But the other thing I love about it is you can slice it up into individual serves and freeze it. It doesn't take a lot of room in your freezer, and then when you get home on a cold winter's night and you don't feel like cooking, if you open up your freezer and spot a bit of meatloaf, just whack it in the oven for 15 minutes, 20 minutes while you do your veggies. We're just slicing the garlic too. Donna loves sliced garlic for some reason. Not that I complain, I like getting a bit of a chunky bit of garlic in my food. You might drift back to sleep. Well, I've been told I put people to sleep. Shady man, so sweet dreams. Hey, Cement Shoes. How are you, Groover? Okay, so we've got our onion. We've got 4 cloves of garlic sliced up. We've chopped up 4 rashers of bacon just before. And the last thing is 1 carrot. And you just want to finely chop this as well. Hi, Crystal Dawn. You've got 2 bags of corn mince in your fridge. Corn? What's it, what is that? I've never heard of it. Meatloaves are good too for people with kids that don't like eating veggies, because you can hide a lot of vegetables in a meatloaf. Like, you could add some grated zucchini. I don't like having too many veggies in my meatloaf. I'd rather do sides, but parents who are constantly trying to work out how to get their children to eat veggies, you can hide a lot of veggies in meatloaves. My mum didn't have a problem with us. We all loved veggies, and we had a little veggie patch and grew our own veggies even from a very early age. And so she didn't really struggle. But then we were also the generation that it was, if you don't eat your dinner, you're not getting anything else. And, you know, we used to get the children starving in Africa line a bit and be like, we'll post it to them, mum, I used to say very rudely. Oh, it's a vegetarian mince. Hi, Crystal Dawn. Hi, Francesca. How are you, Groovers? Yeah, look, a vegetarian mince, I don't see why it wouldn't work. I mean, the only thing is, and you'd know from cooking with it, if you need to add any sort of flours or something, like if it changes the consistency. But if it's pretty much a match for match, then there's no reason it wouldn't work. And Donna's recipes are so yummy and flavoursome, even though she doesn't, you don't need to put, I mean, this has got quite a lot of stuff in it for a Donna Hay, but a lot of her recipes, you know, like that cheats paella I made yesterday, it had 5 ingredients and it was absolutely amazing. It was so yummy. I'm going to have that for lunch tomorrow. Some of it's going to my friend along with a lot of what I'm cooking today, and then I'll probably freeze a couple of lunch size portions because I don't mind that chorizo paella as a lunch. Some fresh spinach leaves on the side. Delicious. Have fun, Francesca, wherever you're going. Yeah, it's just my usual Sunday meal prepping. So I just thought I'll just start going live a bit more and hang out with Groovers if people have anything they want to chat about. I've been listening to a lot of people reacting to that Amber Heard interview, and I'm not going to bother doing it because it just irritates. Yeah, she irritates me now, the whole thing. I'm over it, literally. I'm one of those YouTubers who says they're over it and they don't talk about it anymore. I mean, if there's any sort of appeals or you know, the Australian government decides to sue Amber or anything like that, of course I'll be tuning in. I'm not following the new Johnny Depp trial that's coming up, though. I think I'm going to be very deeply entrenched with the Brittany Higgins. It kicks off on the 27th. I was going to do something about that this weekend, but I've decided during the week I'm going to make like a little intro video just explaining the Brittany Higgins story so people can decide if they want to follow it or not. It's going to be quite serious and heavy. I'll try to make it entertaining. It's not televised, like we don't televise our trials, so it'll be updates each day on what's happening in court. But it has some pretty major ramifications about, you know, what goes on behind Parliament House walls and what politicians get away with. And even though the alleged rapist isn't a politician, it happened at Parliament House and it was just, she's had a terrible time. So, you know, we're hoping that justice will be done for her. Tor will never go hungry. No. Although it's funny, I often cook a heap of shit and then I'm like, I don't feel like eating any of that shit. Right, my pan's very hot. I can see the oil. A couple of tablespoons of oil into a large, big frying pan. Use your biggest, deepest one. We are going to be frying up a kilo of meat. And just chuck all of this beautiful goodness in. Right, sorry, we'll do the bacon first on its own. Just for a few minutes to get it a bit crispy. And I'm also going to make, I picked some beautiful fresh thyme out of my little herb garden just before. I've done a bit of prepping. At some point in this live you'll be like, oh, she hasn't prepped this beef, but so fresh thyme if you grow it, or if you can buy it and it doesn't cost the same as a small house. Otherwise, dried thyme is perfectly fine. You need about 2 tablespoons. So while that bacon is crisping up, I'm just going to remove some leaves off my beautiful homegrown thyme. But no, I never go hungry. But I do cook for like an army. I'm always delivering food to people. Or like when my sister comes over, I'm like, oh, we're having this for lunch. And then I also send her home with stuff for dinner. Like the last time she came here, I've made a macaroni cheese. Did I do that at live? I can't remember. I've made a spinach macaroni cheese. No, I hadn't. I showed it to you guys though. And so we had that for lunch. And then I sent her home with some of that curry pumpkin and cashew soup. Don't you love the sound of bacon cooking? That crackly noise? Probably not if you're a vegetarian. And there's no need to chop your thyme leaves. They're tiny and perfect just the way they are. If you know anyone who grows herbs and stuff like that too, like, strike up a friendship. Or if you see, like, when you're going on a walk and you see someone's got some overhanging rosemary or something like that, just pinch a sprig. If it's on the footpath side, it's public property. But you can't really beat fresh herbs. And I can't grow veggies because of the possums here. And I can't grow fruit for the same reason. But I can grow herbs on my deck. So I have a very luscious herb garden. And I grow things like chilies. And I've got olive trees on my deck too. Although they're about to go down below. About to move them. They've been pretty miserable sitting in pots for the last year or two. So one of them doesn't actually look all that well. So just getting the bacon crispied a bit so it's all sort of caramelized and has pops of flavor. That was the thing I did wrong with the chorizo yesterday. I should have let it go a little bit longer so it had a bit more crunch to it, but it was really beautiful chorizo. So about 2 tablespoons of thyme leaves. Bacon has crispied up and looks fabulous, so I'm going to chuck the onion, carrot, garlic into the pan. And also that 2 tablespoons of thyme. That goes in now as well. Do you kill herbs growing them in pots? Really? No, they're pretty happy out on my deck. When people come to visit, hint hint, I like to send people home with a little posy of herbs from my deck. But winter's really good for herbs too. I usually have basil a pot of basil on my kitchen bench, but it's looking unhealthy, so I've popped it in the bathroom because that seems to be like where a lot of my semi-dead plants go to either die or be revived. So I'm just seeing if the basil likes the steamy bathroom vibe. And you just want to cook the carrot, especially until it's softened, about 5 minutes. While that's going on, we're going to start mixing some stuff into the mince. And I'm just going to take my rings off. You have a big herb garden. Your family thinks you're crazy for having it, because you're the only one who cooks using them. They love it. They would love it. Hi, Lum. Did you dump that all in the bacon grease, or did you drain the grease a bit first? No, it's all gone in with the bacon grease. I trimmed a lot of the fat off, and there was a lot of meat. It wasn't very fatty bacon, but yeah, you leave the bacon grease in as well, because it's going to be cooking a kilo of meat shortly, so you do need a bit of oil, of some oils happening. So there was 2 tablespoons of olive oil and then the little bit of bacon fat, but there wasn't a lot because I trimmed most of the fat off it. All right, so we're going to start putting together the meat part of it, and oats are going to be the ingredient that's going to hold all of this minced meat and everything together. So we're going to get 3/4 of a cup of rolled oats. Just your standard rolled. Don't use instant oats, because I don't know what they put in them to make them instant, but anything you put it in, it gets very slimy. So make sure you're using your good old-fashioned oats. And you want 3/4 of a cup of oats. And then to the oats, we're going to add half a cup. I haven't made this before, Grievers, so half a cup of milk. I'm into the lactose-free milk, so that's why my milk is not in a milk carton. And I learned the other day a hack that you pour these things from the top. See how the pouring bit's narrow down there? So it feels upside down when you first do it, but I don't get those massive things happening now that some of you would know about if you drink milk out of those containers. And just mix the oats and milk together. But this is kind of the binding component in a meatloaf. Lots of meatloafs have different binding components, but for this one it's some oats, and I love oats, so I'm happy. I'm happy. You wish you'd get them to grow. They hide when you go to Bunnings. No, it's a death set. Oh, Deb. Keep trying, you'll find some. Have you tried rosemary? And put rosemary straight into the ground. Have a little rosemary hedge. Rosemary is very hardy. I mean, mine's almost got like wooden stems. It's very established. It's like a little hedge. I mean, mine's in a pot, but I keep thinking about putting some out the front. So the oats and milk, you just want the oats to sit there and soften in the milk again for about 5 minutes. And we're going to be adding all the mince and everything to the oats. So that's what's going on there. Suppose it can stay there. This is all softening up really beautifully as well. It's very pretty. It's looking very pretty. It smells amazing. So I use a Spanish onion because I thought I'd bought enough onions, but maybe the other broccoli soup didn't have a brown onion in it, and this one did. So I chose to put the red onion in this one because it's a tomato-based meatloaf. Yeah, I usually use breadcrumbs too. So it'll be interesting, Lum. See how it goes. I'm quite excited. Everything I cook, I mean, occasionally I'll cook an old favourite recipe that I just want to share with you guys because, you know, it's a winner-winner. But everything I cook on this channel, I cook out of books like Donna Hay, Delicious Magazine, Valley Little, even the Free Coles Supermarket Magazine. Like, I choose relatively simple stuff, but I've got, you know, heaps of Yosha Motolenghi books and Matt Moran and all these other chefs that I love as well. But I try to do pretty easy stuff. So, and I also use my friends as guinea pigs all the time. I'm not scared to try things. And I'll tell you if it's shit too. If we try something, if I make something I haven't made before and it's not great, I'll let you know. I'm quite happy with where that carrot mix and everything is. So I'm actually going to take that off the element for now because it's softened beautifully and it's just looking very, it's looking very pretty. Like, I want to sort of, you know, hopefully get to show you guys a slice, and I want that slice to have some colors in it. I don't want it just to be boring meat colored. You even kill mint. Oh, Deb, just opening the kitchen window because it's I didn't want to have my fan on because it's noisy. But it's on a little bit. But I also love having put the milk back in the fridge. I love having the window open when it's winter and you're getting some sun in the afternoon. Yeah, if you kill mint, that's a skill. Because, yeah, I mean, people, so many people, when they write about growing herb gardens, they're like, don't do mint. It takes over your garden. But I love it. I'd be happy if I didn't have a lawn. I just had all mint. So this is just softening. I'm just giving it a little bit longer before we add the next ingredient, which is a big giant fuck off bowl of a kilo of beef mince. Now, the mince in a meatloaf, lots of people mix up the minces. Like, they'll do pork mince and veal mince and beef mince all together, or, you know, they'll do lamb, or they'll do beef and chicken. I found a kilo of mince meat at the supermarket for $13. You need a kilo for this recipe. I was like, well, that's a bargain. So I'm not mixing it up. Some people do for the flavour. They think it makes a meatloaf tastier. But I don't think it makes that big enough of a difference to, you know, spend a fortune on different mince meats. I mean, if I'd found two 500 gram packs that had equated to less than $13, I would have done it. But hello, Gone Girl. How are you, gorgeous?
Oh, hello, Sunny. What are you doing, honey? Sorry, baby girl.
Why do cats and dogs do that? They stand right behind you and you bump them and they get shitty with you. It's like, I was standing here the whole time and you were behind me. I don't have eyes in the back of my head. That's pretty soft, guys, so I'm happy with that. So here is the $13 worth of beef mince kilo, and it's pretty lean. It looks pretty yummy. But like I said, you can do 500 grams of, I don't eat pork, so I would never do pork mince, but you know, if you're hardcore with your meatloaves and you want to do 50-50 or even three different types of mince, do it. If you've got three small packets in your freezer, oh, Gone Girl, thank you, Sunny. You got rewarded by Gone Girl for me bumping into you because I don't have eyes in the back of my head. Gone Girl just put money into your bank account. Well, it's not just her bank account, it's also 10 lives. Cat Centre. I do a monthly donation in her name. She's a very socially responsible cat. So thank you, Gone Girl. That's very generous. Thank you so much. So So I'm just mixing this through a little bit first before we add all the other ingredients. Just to get a bit of an even spread of the oats and the meat. But normally I wouldn't. Normally I just chuck everything in the bowl and just stir it. But I'm being, I don't know, thorough, I guess is the word. And we're going to add a couple of eggs. They also work as a bit of a binding agent. Just crack them straight into the bowl. Hey, Scout and Quora, how are you? At the moment we're making a classic tomato baked meatloaf. Next I'm going to make a very quick and yummy, hopefully, broccoli soup and a chocolate mousse. And Sunny's very happy because Gone Girl just very kindly put $20 Canadian into her bank account. So that pretty much will cover her monthly donation to the 10 Lives Cat Centre. So thank you so much, Gone Girl. We're going to put in some Worcestershire sauce. Do you guys in the US of A have Worcestershire sauce? It's actually an English sauce, but there is a Tasmanian brand that I nearly bought. I needed to get some more. But I ended up getting a little bottle because I don't use a lot of it. But I really did want to support the local guy. But this is the Worcestershire sauce that we grew up with. Holbrook's. I'm pretty sure it's English, is it? Oh, no, I apologise. It's Australian. New South Wales. For some reason growing up, I always thought this was English. Might be the little dude on the label. If you don't have, oh, you made meatloaf last night. Oh, well, you can do a comparison. This is interesting, Scout, because this one's got oats as the binding ingredient. Did yours have oats or did it have breadcrumbs? You grew up with that one. Yeah, it's very traditional. I think we all grew up with the Holbrook's, which it's really yummy Worcestershire sauce. But I don't know, do you guys in the States have Worcestershire sauce? Because if you don't, just sub it out with soy sauce. You just need a sauce that's going to add a bit of punchy flavour. I googled that before I went live. I was like, what if they don't have Worcestershire sauce in the US of A? You do have it. In the South, you do. Awesome. You can actually make your own, but I didn't have time. It was easy just to go to the shop and grab a little bottle. So 2 tablespoons of Worcestershire. I love it. That would explain why so many of your barbecues in the South are amazing. My God, I just put on 50 kilos just looking at the food when I was in the South, let alone eating it. Also 2 tablespoons of tomato paste. We do tomato paste here in little 2 tablespoon sachets, which is perfect because most recipes need 2 tablespoons. You know, if you buy a jar of tomato paste and use 2 tablespoons and then stick it in your fridge and 3 years later you find the back of the fridge, it's like, oh shit. So if you can buy it in these little sachets, it's worth it because they are all in 2 tablespoon measurements. And I'm all, you know, for not wasting things, so they make me happy. Although this particular sachet is salt reduced, which I'm not happy about. Put the salt back in it, god damn you. It just means I make sure when I'm seasoning I put salt in. And speaking of salt, a nice big chunk of Tasman sea salt. Get into the sea salt, guys. Don't cook with that really fine shit because it's yucky. Oh, well, see, tomato paste is different to ketchup. So what you guys call ketchup, we call tomato sauce. And tomato sauce is runny like ketchup, whereas tomato paste, I don't know if you'll be able to see it in there, that big blob, it's quite thick and condensed. It's very strong. So it's a different thing. But yeah, you can put tomato sauce in or ketchup instead of tomato paste. But that's a really condensed, strong, rich flavour. Just going to give this all a bit of a mix up and definitely make sure you break the yolks. I love this bowl. This is my mum's old French mixing bowls, probably even one of my grandmother's originally. I love it. It's travelled like I've lived interstate on the mainland. It went with me, came back. It's been with me since I left home. It's one of my favourite things that I own. It's fantastic for baking and just, you know, lovely big mix, big old mixing bowl. I don't normally mix with this spoon, but this was my grandmother's spoon, so I'm sort of, I love the beautiful old spoons. But yeah, but what sort of meatloaf did you do, Scout? This one is a baked tomato one. All right, so I've just given that a bit of a mix. And then we're going to add this beautiful bacon mix that we made earlier as well, which came up beautifully and it's all nicely softened. So this is bacon, carrot, garlic, fresh thyme. This frying pan is heavy. What do we have? Bacon, onion, carrot, garlic, and thyme. And pop it all in, even the oil, the whole lot. Right, I've got to find somewhere to put you. Luckily, I tidied up the kitchen before I went live, so there's lots of space to put things. Because I'm three dishes, there's going to be a lot of dishes to do. Haven't got my dishwasher yet, but that's on the list. I'm just waiting for them to go on sale. I'm starting to think I should just go and get it. They're half the price now that they were when they came out about 10 years ago, so I really shouldn't complain. You have one of those? I've got quite a few. That's my big one. I've got lots of dessert spoon size ones as well, and I've got soup spoons. I like it too. Although the soup spoons are the ones I use for Sunny. I like my pets to have their own dedicated spoons. And you want to mix this together really well. Yeah, family heirlooms are fun. Tomato sauce is something totally different from ketchup here. And we also have tomato paste. Oh, we can buy your ketchup here too, but our tomato sauce tastes a bit different, but they're the same thing. Like, if an American came here and wanted ketchup on something, we'd just say, just ask for tomato sauce. And you also have tomato paste. You made meatloaf with cream of mushroom soup and a regular meatloaf with ketchup on top. Oh, nice. This is going to go into a big baking dish with all these tomatoes around it, and I haven't made this one before, so it'll be a first. I'm going to chuck the oven on now too, to 200 degrees Celsius, which is 450 Fahrenheit. No, 400 Fahrenheit. That's come together really well. I'm just going to turn my phone down too. I just got a little thing on my phone reminding me to do meal prep. Meal prep Sunday. Oh, it's the people whose cats I'm feeding. Cool. I send them photos every day just so they know their pets are still alive. They sound really yummy. The other thing I'm going to add too, sorry, I completely forgot one ingredient. I just saw it on the bench. I'm like, have you forgotten me? We're also adding maple syrup. Where's Gone Girl, look. I buy the Canadian shit. And I buy it in a litre bottle too. Maple syrup is very welcome in my kitchen. Just chuck in a quarter of a cup of maple syrup as well, because that's going to add this yummy, sweet, sticky element to the dish. Oh, yeah. So we'll just mix that through.
Sunny.
Let's see if I can get Sunny in the shot. There she is. You're on camera. Can you guys see her feet? She always sits and stands like a little ballerina. Like in first, second, third.
Hello, gorgeous. We're on YouTubes.
There's the shitty kitty. In the shitty kitty kitchen. She wants me to play with her.
I'm cooking, Moogie. Later.
There you go. Little cameo from Sunny for you, Auntie Scout. Just mixing that maple syrup through. Now it's sounding very gluggy. She is stunning, Deb. She's so pretty. I've just put fresh thyme out of my garden. That's the only herb that's gone into this. Sage, Italian seasonings, fresh oregano and garlic. Yum. Well, this has got garlic, bacon, carrot, onion, thyme leaves. Then we have the oats and the milk, the mince, two eggs, Worcestershire sauce, tomato paste, salt, pepper, and some maple syrup. That's where we're up to. You don't usually like meatloaf, but this is coming together nicely. Let's see what the end result's like.
Sonny, I gave you a treat earlier. It's not dinner time, Bubba.
See if we can you see her? She's now sitting where her bowls are. It's not dinner time. It's 1:20 in the afternoon. And you've already had a treat. I'll just give her some fresh biscuits. That might cheer her up a bit.
Put some more kibble. Yeah, I would love nothing more than to be chasing you around the house right now, but I've got a bit going on, kiddo. I'm cooking in your kitchen.
Has Sunny? No, she hasn't got any closer to trying out the new polar. No, she hasn't. The link to the recipe, this recipe, is in the description. So is the recipe for the soup, which is going to, we'll make that next, and it's going to take no time at all. It's going to be very quick and easy. And I will have to write up the chocolate mousse. But if you're still here when I'm doing the chocolate mousse, you can just grab a notepad and scribble it down. It's not a very complex one. Now, we're going to, I'm just going to wash my hands, and we're going to shape this into a loaf. And I'm going to get the dish out that we're going to bake it in. I'm not going to shape it onto the breadboard. I'm going to shape it straight into the dish. Because people do that and they think, oh shit, this is really sticky. And they end up with half the meatloaf on the breadboard, and we'll just shape it in here. It's going to be completely surrounded by tomatoes shortly, so and it's coming out in a big fat, well, it's going to come out in a few big fat blobs. So we're going to shape it like a loaf. I wouldn't be too fussy about it, but you want it to be roughly the same size and shape, and you want it to be so that you can slice it. So you want it to be a bit high. So when you slice it up, you can literally just ch-ch-ch and have beautiful wedges of meatloaf in sandwiches. It's yummy and fresh bread. But that's how easily I did that. And I didn't need to put anything into this dish before. Like I didn't need to put any oil or butter or anything like that. It went straight into this dish. You could also use a roasting tray, and like Scout said too, you could also put parchment in the bottom, but I have done none of those things because I'm a rebel. All right, I'll just get rid of this. The next thing is we're going to add a couple of tins of tomatoes. These are just the Australian supermarket Coles brand Italian diced tomatoes. This can got a bit crushed. I normally don't buy crushed cans, but now I know why they were only 80 cents. And we're just going to add the tomatoes basically around the edges of the dish. Too easy. Sunny, I've opened a can. She thinks it's tuna. You only get a tin of tuna on your birthday. These are tomatoes. I'll show you. I'll give you a lid. Look. You don't like it. You've had tomato before, or you've tried to show interest in it. You don't like it. If you were out in the wild hunting, Sunny, you would not hunt a tomato. I'm pretty certain of that. Where's our wooden spoon gone? Oh, she'll get a clean one because that's got... Oh, I'll just say I'll get a clean one because it's got raw mints on it. Well, duh, what is this? Look at that afternoon sunlight coming into my kitchen. This is why I like these Sunday afternoon cooking sessions. And we're just going to also add a cup of water to this. Just cold water. Just go around the edges. Yum. Yummy. Yum, yum. And we're going to chuck this in the oven for 45 minutes, Groovers. The oven's not quite at 200 yet. But as soon as it is, this will be going in for 45 minutes. Deb has no sound. Yeah, you need to refresh, Deb, because it sounds like everyone knows. Well, it sounds like at least Scout can hear me. But you didn't bake yours. See, I think that's probably why you don't need to grease the baking dish before you pop it in the oven. I've also already put another dish, just a flat baking tray on the shelf below, just in case this gets a bit bubbly and bubbles over a bit. Because, you know, there's maple syrup and stuff in that third dish, and that would create a very sticky blob in the bottom of my oven. We're going to move on after this to the broccoli soup, and the broccoli soup will be a very quick cook. I'll basically keep an eye on the meatloaf too. Like if it sort of gets dark golden brown and it looks like it's cooked through, I'll pull it out of the oven, but I'm going to set a timer for 45 minutes. And then you let it sit for about 10 minutes so that it sort of hardens up and whatever. And then when you slice it, we're going to serve it with some... I'm having it for dinner, but I'll do a taste test. But I'm going to be having mashed potatoes and green beans. But when I do the taste test, I'm going to garnish it with some Parmesan cheese and some rosemary out of my garden. A few tips there for you, Deb, with the sound issue. Right, we're at 200 degrees. Take my glasses off before I open the door because they get fogged up. And in she goes. Happy cooking, good looking. Oh, that was my elbow. That hurt a little bit. Um, 45 minutes. I'm setting a timer so I don't forget it. Anyway, you know, this is another little cook's tip. If you're reheating food or when you're cooking something in the oven, when you can start to smell it, like as it's finished product, it's ready. Just a little tip. Okay, so that's in the oven, and hopefully in 45 minutes, it's going to look a little bit like this. Now, I'm just wondering, should I have covered it with the tomato a bit more? It didn't say to. I think they've just put tomato on top of it for serving before they garnished it. Fixed? Yay. All right, onto the broccoli soup. We're not mucking around, guys. Now, this is the one I was planning on cooking, but I couldn't actually find the recipe to link, and I didn't want to type it up. And it's quite a fancy broccoli soup, but it does have a tahini. I love putting yogurt and sour cream on soups, and this has got a tahini and yogurt sauce, so we're going to make that. So I'm going to keep this recipe open to do that part of it. Just to give you something. There it is. It's like, where's the recipe gone? Just to give you another way of putting a garnish on your soup if you like sour cream and Greek yogurt. Just like we're going to fancy it up a tiny bit and make that tahini sauce. But I did find Donna Hay, and because this is that other recipe was her as well. Oh, another cook's tip. If your bench top doesn't have a heap of liquid and stuff, you just flip your board over. Don't be getting out another board. Just flip it over. You're going to wipe the benches down at the end of the day anyway. So I did find Donna's super quick, super green soup. So we're going to make a very quick and easy broccoli soup. I'm just going to get my big pot. In winter, I usually make one, sometimes two soups a week, and because they're good for lunches, single portions. If you take your lunch to work and you can buy a fresh loaf of bread if you want, you can buy a fresh bun from a local bakery near where you work. Perfect little lunch. Or if you've been doing work out in the garden, it's really lovely to have a pot of soup and you just take out a portion of it and heat it up and have that. Yes, you can freeze this broccoli soup. Now, she says this serves four, but I find with soups I get at least six, sometimes eight serves out of one of her recipes. So, and this has got 2 litres of stock. But yes, you can freeze it. And when you defrost it, you know, like I said, you can make this little tahini dressing. I'll show you how to do that. And all of these recipes, each individual one, will get uploaded to the Shitty Kitty Kitchen in the next week or so. It takes a little while to edit them. But that's why today I'm not cooking 4 different things at once. I'm being a bit more realistic. I'd use the element over here, but you're not really going to see it. I mean, look, at the end of the day, it's just going to be a heap of green things bubbling in a pot. But we're going to turn the pot on. This is another one of these cast iron Le Creusets that I use. I think my camera's rolling down a bit. And cast iron does take a little while to heat up, but also if you need it for a high heat, you want to heat it up at about halfway on your stovetop. Don't go hot full bore with cast iron because it can crack them. But we're going to heat this up. And I made earlier 2 litres of vegetable stock. I just used vegetable stock cubes. I do make my own chicken stock, and I've got 2 cups of chicken stock still in the freezer to use for something. And I've got 2 cups of turkey stock as well, which I could have used for these, but I forgot all about them. But I just made vegetable stock. And I'm just going to pop these straight into the pot. Here's some stock I made earlier. And that's the 2 litre. This is going to get blended up with a stick blender anyway, so don't feel I mean, I've dissolved my stock cubes, but they're going to get blitzed anyway. Okay. So the pot and the stock are warming up. Now this does require a lot of broccoli, but we'll just get this up to boiling before we start adding the veggies, but the stock and the pot can just heat up together. So we're going to get four broccoli heads. Fortunately, broccoli is still relatively affordable because it's not that heavy. These are sort of, I'd call these baby heads, like they're not huge. So I'm using four. But if you buy one of those gigantic broccoli, then obviously just one will do. Or if you get like the slightly bigger sort of size, then maybe two or three will do the trick. And I've got my little compost bowl. And we're just going to... And I'm using the same... I didn't use a knife with the meat. Actually, I'll get fresh knives. I don't want someone to, accuse me of mixing my knives. Now, I actually cook the stems as well, but some people don't. But I'm all for it. You could literally just take the broccoli heads. But I actually cook up the stalks as well. It just means the cooking time's a bit longer, but I'll put these in before that water's at the boil. So by the time they've had a bit of a spin around, and again, I'm going to be blitzing all of this stuff. So, and I'm just doing this as an example. I'm not going to bother with all of them, but just chop them up really finely. My little stick thing will, you cook the stems too? Yeah, it makes things go further and, I mean, they're edible. Why wouldn't you? Sort of. But if you wanted this to, if you got home from work, you could make this soup and be eating it, you know, within half an hour. So some people probably wouldn't do the stalks. But you've just got to break them down a little bit. And they're going to get blitzed, like I said. So just trim off any little leafy bits. But it's all nutrition and it makes the dish go a little bit further too. Thanks for hanging out. Nice little group. Must be something happening on YouTube. Or it's people aren't that interested in cooking. They want gossip, drama. Or Johnny Depp at the moment. But I'm over the Johnny Depp thing. It's done and dusted. I was going to react to Amber and then I've listened to a few other people reacting and they haven't said or thought of anything different that I would have, so I don't really see the point. You don't need 50 channels all saying the same thing. And really, like, I thought she said she just wanted to get on with her life when it was over, so why is she even doing interviews? Like, piss off, lady. Off you go. But while we're waiting for the water to come up, and I'm going to put the lid on the pot because that does speed things up a bit. And not fully on, so I can still see when it's boiling. But in the meantime, I'm just breaking all the little florets off. Again, they're going to be stick blended, so you don't need to chop them up like super finely or anything like that. You can literally just give them a rough chop, which we'll do in a minute. It's 11:35 in New York. Oh, okay. You truly enjoy when you cook and you're thinking. I still want to do some sort of cooking thing with my life at some point. It's my favourite thing to do. I love feeding people. One of my favourite books, like in my top five, is Aphrodite by Isabella Allende, and it's the love of food and food of love, and it talks about aphrodisiacs and, you know, women making food historically for husbands to keep them horny and doing sexy food at a banquet so everyone ends up stripping all their gear off and getting it on together. And but even the book, the paper it's printed on and the artwork, everything, it's just such a gorgeous, sexy book. And it's got beautiful stories, like all of her old aunties and nonnas and mum, they all tell stories about kinky food escapades they have had, and it's a great book. It's really beautiful. So I thoroughly recommend that to anyone who likes. Oh, and it's got all the recipes too. It gives you all the aphrodisiac recipes. Okay, so now we're just going to roughly chop up the broccoli. I'm really just going to be slicing them in half. I mean, it's more just that they all cook consistently, that you chop them up roughly. They're going to get blitzed. My hand blitzer thing is pretty strong, so. You love to bake? Yeah, see, I love to cook and I like to bake. I can do cold desserts and stuff, but my oven's got uneven heat, so baking's frustrating because I've got to remember to stop and turn the pan around, and it's more of a science. Like, cooking is an art and baking is a science. One of my exes told me that years ago and he was very right, very correct. But that being said, I will try cakes and stuff on this channel. Although cakes are sort of tricky because they, you know, you put whisk them together and then they go in the oven. I mean, we can always sit and have a chat, but. That stock's getting close to being on a boil. Four heads of broccoli is a lot of broccoli. Even four heads of little broccoli is a lot of broccoli. A lot. Lots of soup. I might even, depending on what time I finish today, if I've got time, I might even see if my sister's home and take a couple of servings down for her and her husband, because they commented quite a few times about how much they loved having that last soup after they'd been working on their land in the Tassie winter and then came inside and had this beautiful, hot, hearty soup. I might be the soup fan. And we're talking about lovely retro kitcheny things earlier. It is a lot of broccoli, but it's, again, I'd put this in the affordable category. For feeding a family, this soup will feed your family. Get a nice big loaf of crusty bread to have with it, and away you go. Now, those other broccoli stems, I'm going to keep them because I am doing green beans and mashed potato tonight to have with the meatloaf, and I'll thinly slice up those and pan fry them as well. We're nearly at a boil, but talking about beautiful old things, because I love all the retro cooking stuff, look at the cute little dishes I'm going to do the mousse in. They've actually got a blue tint to them, but you probably think the blue's coming off the KitchenAid, but they are actually blue. But I love that retro pattern, the stars. It reminds me of Bewitched. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. You put some mushrooms in your broccoli soup? Yeah, look, there's lots of, they are very cute. There's lots of different soups, but I'm just trying to do, food's got so ridiculously expensive in Australia, like ridiculous. People are paying more for an iceberg lettuce and a bottle of wine here at the moment. Not where I am, but up in Queensland where Finn is. So I'm trying to like do budget cooking. So like I will do a mushroom soup soon because I love mushroom soups. But it'll probably mainly just be the mushrooms. I'm trying to sort of stick to not one ingredient, but you know what I'm saying? Like, because I personally, I'd love to make some minestrone on this channel, but these days getting all the things for a minestrone, even I found a recipe the other day for a soup and I was like, oh my God, that sounds so good. But I realized it was probably going to cost $30 or $40 to make it. Whereas this little thing is probably not going to even cost $15. Boil, you bastard. What do they say? A watch pot never boils. But yeah, the little mousse dishes are very cute. Very cute. Just clean a few things away. Now this doesn't actually have onion. I thought it did. So I could have used the brown onion in the meatloaf, but we used the sweeter red Spanish onion. I just assumed there would be an onion because there usually is in the oops. I'll just grab the frozen peas too. Say too, Scout, the reason there's no mushrooms in this is because this is a green soup. I'm just gonna measure out 240 grams of frozen peas. Oh, it's a bloody iceberg of peas. Shit, shit, shit. Okay, we've gone a bit over. That's all right. The more the merrier. Yeah, I should have mentioned that. This is a super quick, super green soup. Hey, Lee D. Oh, look, it's a wander in, wander out kind of show. I don't expect anyone to hang out with me all day. But I just figure I'm going to be cooking all afternoon. I might as well go live. And if people are looking for somewhere to hang out. Now put the frozen peas in first because they slow down the temperature. They make the temperature go down again. So get them in first because you want the water back up to the boil when you add the broccoli. There's a little tip for you, Groovers. Yeah, but I love your recipes. Well, the meatloaf's already in the oven, lady, so you're going to see that ready-made, and you didn't have to put up with me assembling a meatloaf for an hour. Well, it didn't take me long to assemble it, but... in the sink. Oh, poor Sonny wants to play. We'll play later, buddy, I promise. Got a bit on right now. Here, I'll do some sunny cam while we get the water back up. There she is. She's like, excuse me, I want to play. So there's, you can see my herb garden in the background through the window. I've got thyme, tarragon's looking a bit average. I should have picked that and frozen it before it went yellow. I've got parsley and chives. The chives are nearly done for the season and the parsley's just coming through. Rosemary, spring onions, sage, and
mint and oregano.
And I usually have, and I've got some fennel out there too and some olives. Not fennel, kale. And I usually have basil on my kitchen bench, but it's not doing very well. So it's in the plant hospital. So I've just put the frozen peas in.
Let me get a little thingy doodah. I get creative where I put things on my bench. My bench has got all the ingredients for everything I'm making all lined up, and some things are measured and measuring cups, and
this, my recipe stand is sitting up on top of my KitchenAid too, by the way, if you're wondering what that is. But we'll be making the mousse, we'll be using the KitchenAid, so that's why that's in the shot for once. She doesn't really do the scraps. Biscuit did, because Biscuit was on a very strict diet. Sunny's quite fussy. She probably would have liked some raw beef mince now, come to think of it. I didn't think of that. But like chicken, or if I drop some cheese or anything like that, she doesn't like it at all, whereas Biscuit would have devoured it in 30 seconds. We're about to whack in our broccoli, because the peas and the stock are coming back up to the boil. And I did put some broccoli stalks in there as well, but this is only going to take like 5 minutes, so we might as well whack the broccoli in. So 4 heads of smallish heads of broccoli, but if you can buy those gigantic ones from the farmer's market, like the huge garden broccolis, you'd only need one. Or sometimes the greengrocer has like a middle size. You could use the middle size too. Probably 2 of them, maybe 3. But again, I just love having a pot of soup for the week. I'll pop it into a container in the fridge, and after a couple of days, whatever's left gets put into individual serves in the freezer. And they're great little lunches. I love having soup for lunch, so I usually buy a couple of little fresh buns and have soup for a couple of days in a row for lunch. Because I'm working from home too, like having some home-cooked food ready to go, I have much better lunches when I'm working from home. So this will come back up to the boil, and needs about 5 minutes for the veggies to soften. Yeah, my little helper. I don't know where she's gone now. Oh, she's back again. She's loving it. She's having some of her bickies. Can you see her round bum and tail? She's got the cutest little round butt. I'll just stand here and be the cameraman for a minute while the broccoli and peas are coming up to the boil. We're going to chop up some spinach too. This is a very green soup, Groovers. But the little tahini yogurt sauce that we're going to drizzle over the top of it. Yum. No one's actually here for the cooking, Sunny. They're here for you. Excuse me, I'm going to grab some water. I think I just inhaled some pepper. Something spicy just got me right in the feels. I do notice when making soup, it's different tasting when I do it on the range and in the, yeah, I'm all about on the stove or the range. I've got a slow fast cooker and I've also got an Instapot, and I've never used the Instapot because I started making things with a slow cooker, and even though it's convenient, a lot of things, I don't know, there's just a textural issue that I have with the slow cooker. And even like my curries, I much prefer to make them in this pot and just have this on low during the day and not for 8 hours. Some curries I've probably done for 8 hours, but they just taste so much better. There's just a slimy element to slow cooking, and pressure cooking I don't mind if I want to do something really quickly. But I am later in the week going to make slow cooker spaghetti and meatballs. It's a bit of a cheap meatballs where you skin some sausages and they become the meatballs essentially. And then half an hour before serving, you chuck the pasta in and whack the lid back on. So I'm keen to do that. But yeah, there's just something, it's not right. So I'm actually thinking of getting rid of both of them. For a while I was going to try and do some, a bit of a foodie, catering-y kind of thing, and I thought I'd keep them for that. But I don't actually want to serve food that's slimy. I don't know, there's just, yeah, there's something about the taste. Isn't that interesting, Scout? Because people love them, but... So we're going to get some baby spinach. In winter, I put spinach in absolutely everything. Some of this was getting a little bit tired, but that is perfect for chucking into a soup. And there's a mix. It's fresh and tired. But yeah, when you've got some spinach that's looking a bit lame, a soup is the perfect thing to do. Well, Instapot's a bit like a crock pot, really, I guess. I mean, I bought one because I used to watch Six Sisters on YouTube, and everything they do is Instapot cooking, and some of the stuff they made looked amazing. I haven't given up on it. I'll crank the Instapot this year, but every time I go to do a slow cooking thing, I'm like, and I have actually just bought, weirdly, I did just buy the Women's Weekly slow cooker. Mine's a slow fast one, the Breville. So it's a slow cooker and a pressure cooker. But I did just buy the Women's Weekly 5-ingredient slow cooking one because I was thinking, okay, we're all budgeting 5 ingredients. Hi again, Mavis. We're budgeting, food's getting crazy expensive in Australia, really expensive. So some 5-ingredient recipes. I thought, bugger it, let's do it. And I'll be honest, like, I'll make a few of them, and if they're great, then wicked. But if it's still that sort of wrong texture thing, I'll still make those recipes, but I'll make them in this big pot, not the slow cooker. And I'll get rid of them both. I'll take them down to our community house. They're in really good condition, and they both cost a friggin' fortune. So this is just coming back to the boil now. It looks really pretty, guys, because it's just broccoli and peas, but it's all green, and you know when you start to cook broccoli and that colour comes through? But you want to give this about 5 minutes just to let the broccoli soften up a bit. This is heavy, but I'm doing it for you guys. Look. Look at that. It's looking good. How have you been, Mavis, since I saw you yesterday? So I'm just roughly chopping up the baby spinach. Oh, and the quantity, sorry, about 100 grams, but like I said, this was some spinach. Some of it was starting to get a bit wilty. Perfect for a soup. I think there's probably more like 130 grams, but once you've chopped it up again, like, it goes a long way. This is really affordable family feeding. Or friends. You can see the steam. It actually smells really good too, and it's literally vegetable stock, peas and broccoli, and it smells amazing. Although it might be the meatloaf. Am I looking for a roommate? I've got 2 spare rooms. The meatloaf is bubbling away down below. It's doing its thing. It's looking pretty happy. You're getting hungry. There's always food in this house. I grew up in a house with a mum who was stay at home until we got into our teens, and then she went back to working because my dad was a federal politician, so he wasn't around a lot, so she needed to be home. So we grew up in a house with a lot of cooking smells and music playing, and I always love to have food on the go, because if people rock up, it's nothing better than being able to say to them, I've literally just made a big pot of soup. Would you like a mug of soup? Or this meatloaf's just come out of the oven. Would you like a try? Even if it's just a little tiny sample bit, you know. If they've just eaten, it's like, you've still got to try it. Actually, while that's cooking, I'll do my lemon rind. So you need a lemon. Speaking of things that are looking a bit tired, this poor little lemon. We're going to put a whole, like one lemon rind, and I'm just going to use my little Bart Simpson gadget, my little curly whirly maker for the zest. Some people would just peel it, you can grate it, whatever you want. Just chuck it straight on top of the spinach because it's all going to go in together. So this will add a nice acidic tang to our green soup. But basically the zest of a lemon. If you've got a microplane, you could use that. Doesn't matter. Just the rind somehow, however you want. And the lemon juice is going to go in as well. Now, as always, I've been mucking around a bit while we've been live, but you could literally cook this in under half an hour and have it on the table with a nice big sourdough loaf, and your family will love you because I'm sure it's going to be delicious. But you really could do these three dishes as a dinner party. You could start with the green soup, have the meatloaf in the middle and the chocolate mousse at the end. I was going to buy some fresh berries to put on the mousse tonight, but punnets, a little tiny punnet of raspberries or blueberries at the moment is $7.50. And I've got plenty of frozen berries, so what I'm going to do is take them out and mix a little bit of caster sugar through them, and then they'll defrost and it'll kind of create a little bit of a sauce. And I'm just going to use them with a blob of cream. You'll bring the wine. You're welcome anytime. Okay, now we do... Oh, I've got to just quickly go out to my herb garden and get some mint. Sorry, I'll be back. Okay, so I'm just going to whack the spinach and the lemon zest into the pot. Give that a bit of a mix. And we're also going to do the juice of the lemon. Now, people have those little lemon juice things, but I do Jamie Oliver lemon. Use your hand and just squeeze and manipulate the lemon, and it goes between your fingers, and usually when I do it Not one pip comes out, but one pip did come out, but the pips float. This is going to get blitzed anyway, but remove the pip. And then the other half. But yeah, I think hands are your best kitchen utensils, Groovers. I do have a lot of gadgets. I've got friends that buy me a lot of stuff for the kitchen and I buy them stuff for their kitchen. But at the end of the day, a lot of it you can do with your hands. And I think that is the best way to squeeze a lemon. Even though they're two pips for good luck. So I wash my hands. Get another chopping board. All right, so we give that all a nice little mix. Just going to turn it down a bit. It's happily boiling away, but being an enamel pot, I mean a cast iron pot, it's very full of heat now and it's having a field day. We're also going to add some chopped, well, parsley, but my parsley is only just starting to come through. But that's my little homegrown parsley. So I did grab a few little pieces of it, but I didn't want to take too much because it's only just coming through. And then I grabbed a heap of mint. So you probably want about a tablespoon of each. But I've actually gone lots of mint, not so much parsley. And if you've got any herbs in, actually I've got some parsley in the fridge. I do have emergency dried, semi-dried, not the dried, like you have to sort of use it within a week of opening kind of stuff. I don't know, a few weeks. But I've put a tiny bit of my own homegrown parsley in because I think that just adds to it being love food. It's having your homegrown herbs. We've used a lot of my herb garden today. Not a lot of it, but a lot of things from it. Let's get the leaves off. And I think peas and mint are just divine. So I'm happy to go a bit heavy on the mint. One of her broccoli soups is just mint. It's the only herb she uses in it. So just roughly chop this up as well because it's all going to get blitzed. Like literally... roughly chop, so a couple of tablespoons of fresh herbs out of the garden. Yum. And they get blended through as well, mixed in. Okay, weird ingredient coming up, but it's a bit of a thickener. And it also adds some nutty flavour, according to Donna. We're going to add 120 grams of almond meal. Now, almond meal is different to almond flour. But if you've got almonds that have the skin off them and a coffee bean grinder, you can chuck them into that and you can make your own almond meal. I just happen to have some, so I'm using up my pantry stuff. But she loves it because she says it adds a nutty flavour. And also a bit of textural, like thickens it a little bit, I guess. So just measure out 120 grams, so I can show you. I mean, this is a 400 gram bag, so like a quarter of the bag. I've never put almond meal in a soup before, so I'm curious, guys. Yeah, I know. You've never seen almond meal? So that's what 120 grams looks like. It's quite a lot, probably a cup and a bit, maybe even two cups, a cup and a half, I don't know. But anyway, we're chucking that in. You haven't seen almond meal? Well, like I said, you can make your own because it is literally just ground almonds. So if you've got a bag of almonds that have been skinned, that sounds brutal, doesn't it? Skinned and blanched. If you put them into a coffee bean grinder, you could make your own. Yeah, look, a lot of recipes use cornstarch and flour as well for us. Like I said, it's the first time I've ever done that, but we're living on the edge. And lastly, we're just going to add some salt and cracked pepper. And I'm turning off the element. I'm actually going to take it off the element because the spinach has wilted and that's all it needs to do. Like this, honestly, if I hadn't have been doing this live, a bit like that paella I made yesterday, this would have all been done and on the table within half an hour. Really simple and quick. But chattering away and doing sunny cam and everything else. So I'll just give that a bit of a stir through so I can show you what it looks like before we blitz it. Hot pot. There you go, gravers. I've never heard of it in soup either before. It's, like I said, why not? It's Donna, though, and I trust Donna. So I'll get this over here. There we go. Why was I lifting this hot, heavy pot up? I could have just done that. Just going to assemble my stick mixer. Don't need that middle bit, Tori. There is going to be a bit of background noise in a minute, or noise, because I'm about to blitz up my soup. But you could use this, you could do this in a blender. I just find stick mixers are easy, less to clean, and you can alter the settings, like you can go high or low. I always start my soups on low and see how we go. And we're just going to blend this until it's smooth. Very easy to make and very quick. Like, honestly, it seriously would take 15 minutes. Because you don't have to cut everything to size and... But when I've finished blending this, I'm going to show you this tahini yogurt dressing that we're going to drizzle on top of it as an alternative to just putting a blob of sour cream or a blob of Greek yogurt. And, you know, for editing up these videos, I'll be able to pull each thing out individually and put it on the Shitty Kitty Kitchen. So for this recipe, I'll say serve it with the tahini and yogurt dressing, or whatever you want to call it, garnish. I'm actually going to crank this up to high. Mid high. Otherwise, we'll be here all day. You've just bought a stick mixer. Well, yes, you can use it. Make congratulations, you'll never look back. I mean, people buy the Breville's, bar mixers that cost a gazillion dollars. These Breville's are just as good, in my opinion. Sorry if you bought a bar mixer. Some people like a bit of chunk in their soup, but I think if you're doing a blend, you want it fully blended. Sometimes I'll keep some veggies out separately and I'll pan fry them and put them on top, but not this time. Looking good. I think that's pretty consistent. I can't see any bits of broccoli left floating around, so that's where we end that one. Now, because it's a green soup, oh, the meatloaf, right on time. Because it's a green soup, like, you're going to have different colours of shades of green. Like, there's no point blitzing this for 28 hours to get it all the same green. So it has got flecks through it, as you can probably see. It wasn't that loud. Oh, good. So I'm just going to pop that in. I'll pop the lid on there. These, another reason why I love the cast iron stuff is it will keep, this pot will keep hot and keep the soup hot for ages. Because I'll do that tahini sauce. I want to bring the meatloaf out now and see how it's doing. Let's check on our meatloaf, see how it's traveling. So this is the baked tomato. Let's move my mouse out of the way. I can see that melting. Oh my God. Wow, all right. She's looking pretty, pretty. I'm gonna do something a bit cheeky. And just drizzle some of this over the top, and I'm gonna put it back in for another 5 minutes. Like, it's pretty brown on top, but I'm just going to give it 5 minutes with this tomato sitting on the top so it all sort of caramelizes in and melts on top of it. Because the meat underneath is beautifully browned. But we'll whack him in. Look at it, guys. My God, it's incredible. It looks so yummy. It smells amazing. Pop him back in for another... Well, I'm going to pop that back in for as long as it takes for me to show you how to make this tahini sauce. I'll get my little glasses back on. So this other fancy broccoli soup of Donna's has this tahini yogurt dressing, and it is literally just Greek yogurt, tahini, and in fact I'll do it in a small bowl. And water, that's all it is. But if you have, if you're into tahini and you've got it in your fridge and you've always got yogurt in your fridge, why not make a slightly fancy dressing? So I make my own yogurt. This is a Greek yogurt I made. I have to use it up by the 27th. Oh, meatloaf and then meatballs. Oh, so you use your meatloaf and make meatballs. That's a good idea. That's a great idea. So I'm going to put about a third of a cup. I mean, I'm just going to wing this. I'm not going to do measurements, but I will put a proper recipe up for you. But... because I'm just, oh, actually, no, I'll make it properly. Hang on. Because I'm going to be eating this soup and I'll take some over to my... friend as well. All right. So you want a third of a cup of Greek yogurt. Like I said, I make my own, but people usually have... yogurt in their fridge. It's very versatile. It's very good for you. But yeah, I might as well show you the proper way to make it so you get all the ratios. And then the tahini. This is just the Coles supermarket brand and it's perfectly fine. It's actually quite delicious. Thanks for the... Oh, thank you, Lee. Yeah, I haven't uploaded anything to there yet, but that is essentially my library of things that I cook on this channel. but I haven't been cooking on here for a while. It's usually it's winter I get really fired up, and then summer comes along and I'm like, they don't want to learn how to make a salad. And then I eat these amazing salads and I'm like, you should have taught them how to make this salad. Or shown them how to. Just giving the tahini a bit of a stir because the oil always settles up on the top. Not that that's a bad thing, but... And tahini, if you make pancakes, pancakes, then a layer of tahini like you'd put on butter, for example, and then sliced bananas and then some like pan-fried bananas that have got a bit of sugar with them and it's all a bit caramelized. So yummy. But about 2 tablespoons, so I'm just going to put about 4 teaspoons in. Well, actually, no, I've just put pretty much... a shitload. Whatever works, Groovers. And then because tahini can be really thick, especially towards the bottom of the jar, she does mention water as well, but this isn't going to need any water because the... Oh, I might put a tiny bit in actually. But you want it like the same sort of consistency as if you were doing a blob of yogurt. No, it's fine. Like a blob of yogurt or sour cream. There, I'm blocking the sun. And that's it. Delicious and nutty and something a little bit different to what you'd normally... pop on top of your soup. It looks like a grey pooped mustard. It's delicious. What are you talking about? So I'm just going to do a little sample of the soup so I can do the taste test. And I'm going to posh it up a bit with some of her suggestions. So I happen to have this dukkha, which I haven't opened. It's best before the 14th of July next year. But again, eat your way through your pantry. I just happen to have an unopened thing of Egyptian dukkha that I obviously at one point was going to make something with dukkha and grabbed it, and I've never actually used it. So, oh, poupon mustard. Okay, not poo-poo. God, the sun in here is beautiful, but it's not great for you guys trying to watch. And I don't have blinds. So I'm going to just put some soup in here and then I'm going to get the meatloaf. It's quite a thin soup actually. The almond meal might be more about the flavour than the thickening. Let me just get this meatloaf out of the oven. Oh, yes. Yeah, baby. Oh. Oh, my God. That looks amazing. That's just going to sit there, though. The meatloaf has to sit for 15 minutes before we can even slice it. And I haven't even made the mousse yet, the chocolate mousse. But that is actually dinner for me, but I am going to do a taste test for you guys. So... just to do a bit of a fancy garnish, but you seriously could do, sorry about the sun, guys, you seriously could do just a little blob of sour cream or a blob of yogurt, but just to do a taste test, I'm just going to put a little blob of that tahini and yogurt mix. I'm going to put some pumpkin seeds, and I'm also going to sprinkle some dukkha. And look at that. How posh is that, Groovers? It's a really pretty green. I'm sad that the colour isn't conveying, but it is actually a very pretty soup. It's looking a bit grey when I show it to you guys, which is not what I was hoping it would look like, because it doesn't look like that. How can I show you it's green? I'll take a photo of it and I'll put it on my community post later. But it looks very pretty and very green. And with that yummy garnish, the pepitas and a bit of dukkah to add some yummy spices. And yeah, that's an Egyptian flavoured one. And I'm going to do a taste test. So this is a taste test for the super easy, what was it, super quick, super green soup. Broccoli, peas, I'm just mixing the tahini through it a bit. Broccoli, peas, spinach with the main greens in it. Oh, oh, yum. Mm. Very nutty, but not in a bad way. And the seed, the little sesame seeds in that dukkah, but the lemon juice is the key as well. Mmm. Yum. But it's a much prettier green than it's coming up on my screen, so you'll just have to believe me. And then putting some tahini and Greek yogurt together. I probably would put a little bit of water in that just so it can really drizzle it. This is more of a blob. I can't really taste the almond meal. I just think the whole thing's got this sort of yummy, green, fresh, light, nutty sort of flavour to it. There's still little bits of the broccoli stalk that are adding a bit of crunch as well, which is really yummy. No, it's quite a fine, it's quite runny. It's really yummy. I'd make this in summer too, because it's very light, like it, with especially with the lemon juice, it's got a very light, fresh sort of flavour to it. But in winter with a massive sourdough loaf that you toast and serve it with lashings of butter. Oh yeah. And this tahini and yogurt, like, it's worth it just to fancy it up a bit. It's really good. This is a 10 out of 10, guys. It's really affordable. It's very easy to make. If I just grabbed a couple of heads of broccoli driving home, because I've usually always got frozen peas and spinach here, and this would be whipped up and on the table within 15 minutes, and it's a winner. It's a 10. I can't fault it. It's affordable. It's seasonal, although it'd be yummy in summer because you wouldn't have the hot stove going for very long. It really only took 15 minutes total. And the dukkah is I've never thought of putting dukkah on top of a soup before either, so, yum. I'm getting little pops of spinach, and then you get little pops of mint, and then the pepitas are yummy to crunch on. It's really good. I can't fault it. I thoroughly recommend it. I'm just going to pop this back in the fridge. But yeah, I would actually add some more water to that and thin it out a bit so that it, you could really drizzle it around the outside of the soup. That is very good, Grievers. All right. So, at the 2 hour mark, we're going to have a little 5-10 minute break. I need to go to the loo. I want to go and have a ciggy and a little reset before we come back and make the chocolate mousses, the chocolate mousses. And I'm just going to go to my channel and find a little cooking video that I've done in the past that I can stream for intermission. Why isn't it letting me load more than one page of content? Now I've got the flick through. I'll find some little, hopefully, 5 or 10 minute little video that I can just put on of some other thing that I've made. Although all the short versions have probably ended up over on the Shitty Kitty Kitchen now that I come to think of it. I'm just trying to find something on my channel, like a little intermission video, while we regroup and reset before we do the chocolate mousses. Because this is me cooking at home on a Sunday and I need to go to the loo. I never cook straight for like 4 hours without a quick little break somewhere along the way. Scattered pictures. I suppose I could have just put some music on. All right, if there isn't a 10-minute video coming up in the next row, I'll put some music on. I clearly talk a lot on this channel. Oh. Hang on, where'd it go? Oh no, it's 45 minutes. What are you doing? All right, can that idea. You make the quiche all the time? I don't think I've done the quiche in a, Oh, actually. Why don't I just go to the Shitty Kitty Kitchen? Oh, because it's incredibly hard to type on my laptop because it's literally standing upright, wedged in between all the bits and pieces. Oh, shit, I knew I shouldn't have opened that because it was on my channel. You need to go to your other channel. It's been such a long time. It's not in the... Oh, for God's sake. Why am I even doing this, guys? I should have just said, I'm having a break. I'll be back in a minute. That's what other people do, right? Yeah, everyone needs to just go on a break. I will... get YouTube up and see if I can find. It's really hard to type on my keyboard because I've got my camera and microphone and all kinds of stuff right in front of it and it's standing upright, which isn't really, you know, like a natural way to type. So I'm one finger typing as well. By the time I get something up, it will have all left. All right. Now, Scout said the quiche. Did I do a short version of the quiche? No, I can't find the friggin' quiche. Oh, the tomato and basil. No, it's not a short version. It's 1 hour and 26. I need to go over here and make some short versions of stuff. There's a lot of long versions. I thought there were a few shortish ones that I've done. Why can't I find one? Like I made taco soup and I know that I've edited videos. That's very strange. I'm just going to play music, guys. I'll be back shortly. I'm seeing these guys in a couple of months and I put Scout onto them. So we're just going to have a bit of 1927 while I just sort myself out. I've just got to go to the loo. I'll be back very soon. getting there. I'll see you in a minute, Groovers. I didn't have the... It doesn't matter, Joey. I was just playing a song while I went to the loo. It's all right, babes. I didn't have echo cancellation because I'm cooking. Doesn't matter. You're obsessed with the echo. Groover, I was busting to go to the loo. I'm 2 hours into a cooking live and I just put a song on. Sorry about the echo. 5 years of 2027. Now, that's a good comment. Joey Wilson's obsessed with echoes. So, we've got the soup done, and the soup was a 10 out of 10. I thoroughly recommend that, guys. Like, really affordable, yummy, wintry or summery would be nice too. Great little starter for a dinner party, but also beautiful on its own with a, you know, yummy, crunchy sourdough loaf. Meanwhile... Over here, the meatloaf is amazeballs, Groovers. Like, it looks absolutely divine. I'm going to do a taste test of that, but I'm going to do that after we make the chocolate mousse. and it requires a few garnishes and so on.
So now we're going into chocolate mousse land, and the OCD in me,
I just have to clean my stovetop because I can't handle having splatters on it, and clean up this space. Every time you move your, unplug your computer or leave StreamYard, you've got to go back in and do settings, and I wasn't actually planning on playing anything. I just really needed to go to the loo. So, sorry about that echo. Just meant you heard 1927 twice. And I'm seeing them in November. I'm a bit excited. I can't deny it.
All right.
So, we'll do the soup and the garnish a bit. I mean, the meatloaf and the garnish a little bit later. But we're going to make a chocolate mousse, Groovers,
and a very easy one. This out of the way. You should see the chaos that is my home after I go live cooking. The cleanup's ridiculous. I put old seasons of Survivor and watch them while I'm cleaning up. It takes forever, but I love it. And I've got a lot of food to package up and deliver as well.
The meatloaf looks pretty amazing, but yeah, we'll have a crack at that later. It won't be hot, but I don't mind. I'm having it for dinner, so I don't want to eat mountains of it. But the chocolate mousse, we're going to use the KitchenAid. That's why it's in the shot. We're going to do some whisking. Grabbing my whisk attachment for the KitchenAid.
And the little bowl, I think. And we need 4 eggs. Now, I didn't take them out earlier, which is a big no-no when you're cooking. Like baking, your eggs should be at room temperature,
but with a mousse, it's a chilled dessert, so who cares? And we're going to separate the 4 eggs. I don't think you need to see me separating 4 eggs, but basically we're separating the yolks and the whites. So that's what I'm doing right now. But this is another Donahay. It's all Donahay today. And no, I'm not sponsored. Iris Perez, where do I buy my meats from? We've got a fabulous butcher down where I live. He's a 7th generation butcher. He has a cutting, like a butcher's block, that has the biggest dent in the middle of it. And if you go in there and say, I want some lamb cutlets Frenched, he Frenches them for you with a massive machete. However, for the meatloaf, I had to go to a supermarket to get a couple of the things that Sunny eats. Her kibble comes from the supermarket, and a couple of cleaning products that I use, and they had a kilo of beef mince for $13. So I don't normally buy supermarket meats, but $13, trying to do budget cooking, I couldn't say no. So I've just separated 4 eggs. We wake up Shady Batman with the music. Welcome back, Shady Man.
I'm just taking out a little tiny piece of shell out of the egg white.
And whacking them in straight into this little KitchenAid. we're just going to whisk these until soft peaks form. Sorry about the sound. What do those faces mean, Iris? You're laughing. So we're just going to whisk these until soft peaks form. It does take a while. So if it's a bit noisy, just mute me for a while, groovers. Iris, you haven't explained your funny little face emojis. These will all end up on the shitty kitty kitchen, but I do need to do some serious editing. We're getting close to soft peaks forming too, by the way. Oh yeah, KitchenAids are amazing. But you know, my mum and my grandmother had amazing mixmasters, and they were awesome too. But they certainly do make life easier. Just popping this out. So we've got the soft peak level that I like. Just push that through the whisky bit. Like so. We are going to be mixing some sugar in a second. Find a clean board and put this on it. And this is add a couple of tablespoons of caster sugar. It's a really fine white sugar. I don't know what you guys call it. Do you guys call it caster sugar too? But a couple of tablespoons. Now, I do measure when I'm baking, making desserts and things like that. I do actually measure. I'm a bit more random with savory stuff, more instinctive, I guess. And we just want to whisk this again. Oh, whoops. We want this to be thick and glossy. You go to a butcher as well. Yeah, butchers are awesome. I rarely buy supermarket meat, but I'm trying to do budget cooking on this channel, and $13 for a kilo of minced meat, or what you guys would call, shit, I remembered it earlier. What do you call minced meat? Ground beef. $13 is pretty good value. So we've just given that a little bit of a mix, and essentially her descriptive is thick and glossy. And that's kind of thick and glossy. I'm just going to pop that out of the way for a sec, because we've got to do the chocolate bit next. I meant to put this on earlier, so I'm just going to boil the kettle. Just going to pop some water in the saucepan. And one of the reasons I decided to do a chocolate mousse was, like I said, I'm starting to cook through everything in my pantry, and I had all these bits of like chocolate that I'd had to buy for other recipes, like little bits left over. So I was like I've got some, this is actually dairy, like milk chocolate buds, and I've got some milk chocolate, some dark chocolate as well. So I thought I'm just going to use up these little random bits of chocolate to make the mousse. We need 200 grams. I have made the soup. It got a 10 out of 10, Shady Man. It was delicious. So yeah, 200 grams of chocolate. I've got a mixed selection, Deb. But Cadbury is amazing, yes. Well, these are little buds. But use them up. And now I'm going to open this block, so then I'm going to have another block that's open that I'll need to use up. I might make those brownies that Kim Animal was talking about. Oh yeah, I've done the avocado mousse too, Joey. This is the really basic. Oops, I only took two rows of that. So anyway, we'll be making something else, and I'm going to eat these two pieces. This is a four ingredient. I'm about 40 minutes away. I drove past it the other day when we went to Mona. It's away. It's not just down the road. But yeah, so we've got a combination of Lindt and Cadbury. But I'm just going to chop them up a little bit just so they're a bit like the milk buds. So then. Keep moving the little recipe. But this is a heatproof bowl, obviously. And you need a saucepan with boiling water, but you don't want the bottom to touch the you don't want the bottom of the bowl to touch the water. But this is how we're going to melt the chocolate. And it's not going to be tempered. Well, it probably will be, I guess, but it's essentially we're just going to melt. We're going to melt this fucker. It's already starting to get nice and melty. It's already starting to melt because of the boiling water cheat. You were on catch up, the soup making. Cadbury's made in Tasmania. And in England, yes. But the Cadbury factory in Australia is in Tassie. So this little mismatched bowl of chocolate is now all melting, starting to melt. And you've got the water boiling underneath, but it's just the heat that is melting the chocolate. And a lot of you already know how to cook, so you're like, yeah, duh, we know that. But for those of you who don't know, and it's worth just keeping an eye on it and mixing it as you go. I think it speeds it up personally. I'm just going to get the cream out of the fridge and a whisk. But this is literally four ingredients. Eggs, chocolate, sugar and cream. All of our favourite food groups are represented. A very basic, very easy chocolate mousse. I haven't made it. I can just tell because the chocolate mousses I've made before were not this straightforward. But yeah, for people who bake, you've probably often got little half-eaten, half-used-up bags of cooking chocolate and stuff. So have a look in your pantry, and if you do, grab some cream, make some mousse. Washed my little... Oh, you worked near the Mars factory. Did it smell? I was going to say, yeah, sickening. Yeah, Cadbury's has an aroma that not everyone is fond of. This is melting beautifully. These take about 3 hours to set, so it'll be perfect, just in time for dinner. But very easy, and if I wasn't doing this live and chatting away and whatever, like if you just got on with it, again, it's a pretty speedy thing to make. It's not a long process. It just looks longer because I'm chatting while we do it. But as soon as your chocolate is melted, take it off the pot. And I'm actually having green beans and mashed potato for dinner with the meatloaf, so I'll keep this water and use it later, probably to do my spuds. Okay, she's melted. Too easy. That element's actually red for me, but just to show you how wonky colours are on YouTube, for some reason you guys see purple. I've had people go, oh, I love your purple element, but anyway, what we're going to do is add a quarter of a cup of cream to the chocolate. I'll take my spatula out. And the four egg yolks from the eggs we separated earlier. And we're going to whisk them and combine it. This bowl's hot, but give it a good whisking, bit of elbow grease. Bit of elbow grease. Now swap out my bowls on my KitchenAid for a sec. So this is what I mean. Some of this I would have done. A bit differently. I've got stuff everywhere. This is the downside of cooking three dishes. You get to the end of the third dish, there's not a lot of bench space left. All right. We want to put a cup of cream into this bowl. This is thickened cream, by the way, but you could use pouring cream or whatever you call your creams. Oh, you just asked. I'm not reading chat at the moment much, guys, because I'm under the pump. I don't want the chocolate to harden. But, yeah, I'm using thickened, but the recipe just says to use, like, a pouring cream, a thinner cream. It really doesn't matter. Whatever you've got works, in my opinion. I'll read chat in a second, guys. This one is a bit of a race against the chocolate. But we just want to whisk this cream up. But like I said, if I was doing this on my own, I would have things, all the machines going at the same time and all kinds of stuff going on. I'm just whipping the cream, by the way, guys, till we get some peaks on it. That's what I'm up to at the moment. Shall do. That's whipped cream now. And make sure you get all that luscious cream out of your whisk attachment as much as you can, because it's cream. It's cream. We don't want any cream crimes. Okay. Then, ever so elegantly, we're going to add the chocolate. To the cream. And using this. Oops, sorry, noise pollution. Awesome spatula. We're going to get every single bit of it out. Shove that chocky in. Yeah, baby. And the eggs we whipped earlier. All goes into the bowl with the cream. Sorry, I'm left-handed, so I kind of do things in the worst direction possible for the camera. Like, you always get to see this sort of shit. But my hand's a bit of a wash, and we'll mix this together. You want to fold it through to combine. What do you mean fold in the cheese? Just fold it in. Who watches Schitt's Creek? Don't beat the shit out of it. You fold it. Fold it over, and eventually it'll all come together as this big, yummy, chocolatey, delicious, sludgy mousse mixture. With folding in the cream. Now I can't read chat because this is in the way. I had to put the recipe where I could see because it's right on the fold. It's right on the fold. But we're done anyway. So I can get that out of the way now. So we'll just finish folding in the egg whites and the cream and the chocolate. And then you're going to see my pretty little mousse cups. I've got quite a few. I collect retro. Can you lick the bowl? Where are you going, BDSM cream? Don't you go anywhere, Joey. I do collect retro and vintage chilled dessert cups, bowls, serving things. Just make sure you're getting all the cream, all the chocolate from the bottom, fold it through, and there we have it. Now, it's not as dark as a lot of mousses because there is quite a lot of milk chocolate in there and the dark cooking chocolate. It is darker than it looks to you guys. Oh, yeah, berries on top for sure, and even a blob of whipped cream if you're feeling a bit indulgent. And these are my super cute retro dishes that I'm going to be... Look at my arm. I'm covered in chocolate. I'm just going to clear my arm because that's bugging me. But these gorgeous little bowls, and they do have a bit of a blue tinge to them. They're gorgeous. I'll just clear my arm. And we're just going to spoon that into... I've got to find a friggin' spoon. That doesn't have slots in it. Mm. I'll use this one. It's a bit small. Actually, I'm not going to use this. This will make fast work. You get a bit of a scrub. Aren't they cute? I love all the little retro dishes. So yeah, this will take about 3 hours to 2 to 3 hours to set. And fresh raspberries, strawberries or blueberries, beautiful berries at the moment in Tassie for one pun at $7.50. No thank you. I've got a heap of frozen berries. I've got blueberries, raspberries and strawberries in the freezer. And I'll take some out and mix them with a tiny bit of caster sugar and maybe even, I love strawberries with balsamic vinegar and sugar. If you've ever had that, it's so good. But just spoon, the mousse. It should make 6 little chocolate mousses. This is the one I'll be having tonight because it's got mousse on the edges. I'll do a taste test. But yeah, so I've made it. They're a bit messy, but they're not for a dinner party. So, oh, it tastes really good. It is definitely a milk chocolate mousse. So it's not a dark chocolate mousse, but some fresh berries on top. And even a little blob of, oh God, Tori. That's not the one for the money shot at the end. So anyone who visits me this week will be getting a chocolate mousse with their cup of tea. your... Are you surprised I never opened mine? Yeah. Me too. I'm surprised I didn't go ahead with MasterChef, really. To be honest, that's my big regret in life, was pulling out of season two. But I was madly in love with an Amber Heard type. I was madly in love with the narcissist who talked me out of doing it. And because it didn't meet, you know, it didn't fit our plans. Or his plans, and I stupidly... Well, no, there were other reasons too. I mean, I didn't like George Colombaris and would have been kicked off for calling him a cunt, because he was. But, yeah, and I just started a new job. There were a lot of factors. It wasn't just my shitty ex-boyfriend. But if I have a regret when I'm lying on my deathbed, that's it. Because I can't imagine what my life would have been like had I done it. Mind you, I love the life I've got, so, you know, the regret isn't there that I didn't end up with a great life. But it could have, would have, I reckon, changed my life. Toria eating it, who are you saying sorry to? Nobody. I'm all about the mess. This makes more than six of these little cups, though, and I've only got five. There's one missing from this set. It's almost like a quest to find an identical one to make it a set of six again. But you can serve your mousses in little ramekins. You don't have to have the little funky retro dishes. But... And the little trick is when you've put your mousse in, you give it a bit of a shake and a on the bench. Just going to go and get another one of my little... A messy cook is an amazing cook. This many, but I just brought these to show you another set that I've collected that are really cute as well. And there's more, but the other ones are more of a creme brulee or a panna cotta. They're a much bigger dish. I think I'm only going to need one. But I will need a spatula. And I've got one over here, I think. Alright, Ski. So yeah, it has made six little mouses. This is probably the one I'll have for dessert tonight because it's probably not going to be very full, and if this dish is a bit big for what's left. But anyway, waste not, want not. And yeah, you put these little babies in the fridge, 2 to 3 hours, done. Absolutely easy for a dinner party. Like, they're so easy. 4 ingredients. Get some yummy fresh berries. You could do some grated chocolate on top. A blob of cream, and your guests will swoon. And so easy. And you've used up all that sort of mismatched chocolate that was sitting in your baking cupboard or box or basket, wherever you put all your baking stuff. Mine's a basket in my pantry. Little wire basket full of baking shit. I think I'm wearing more of this last mousse than actually... And just cover them with glad wrap, plastic wrap, cling wrap, saran wrap, or your little wax reusables, whatever you've got. I actually buy from Coles supermarket again. They should sponsor me, but I buy plant-based cling wrap, which is fantastic because it's biodegradable. It vanishes. You put it in your compost and it's gone. I love that they're making stuff like that now. Because I did try the wax covers and I still do use them for some things. But they do not keep food fresh the way cling wrap does. They just don't. I don't care what anyone says. So I can't do a taste test for you for the mousse. But from the little bit that I did try, they were vintage. The other ones I showed you, yeah, they're vintage too. These little guys. These are vintage as well. They're a little crystal bowl. And then I've got some other coloured glass ones that are beautiful too. Yeah, plant-based cling wrap. It's brilliant. Brilliant. Guilt-free. Because, yeah, I do use the wax things for some stuff still. But I find that a lot of food can dry out more quickly, and it's kind of like, well, you're doing the right thing by the environment, but then you're ending up, you know, chucking out food because it hasn't stayed fresh for as long as it should have or could have. You've got your Nana's mousse dessert. I think they only ever came in sets of six. I mean, I've got about four sets. And the ones, these little star ones are my favourites. My sister actually gave me those ones. And she reckons there's a sixth one somewhere, but she can't find it. So that's that. They're done. I'm going to pop them into the fridge. We do crazy stuff here, Shady Man. My fridge crisper is right down the bottom and it's got a little drawer that's perfect for these. Done. So that is possibly the easiest chocolate mousse recipe. I think dark chocolate is better than milk. The cooking chocolate was only 40%, whereas I'm more of a 70 and 80%. So it's a more family-friendly one, the milk chocolate. It's still really yummy. Thank you, Deb. I've got a lot of vintage kitchen items. They're fun. But I don't have a microwave oven. Like, I try to cook from scratch all the time as well. So the meatloaf, which is now cooled down a bit, I'm just going to slice a little bit off to show you what it looks like on the inside, and I'll do a little taste test. But this is actually my dinner. I'm going to have this with some mashed potato and some green beans. And but I want to do a little taste test to show it to you guys. And because I'm going to take some of this over to my neighbour later, and I'm also cooking this for a friend of mine, I'm just going to be doing slices, but I really just want to show you a slice of it so you can see what it looks like. Excuse fingers, everybody. Oh, yum. Oh, yum. Oh, yeah, baby. Again, the colour's shit. This is really rich colours. It's a goldy, browny colour. It's really nicely browned on top. Part of the end fell off, but just to show you how I would garnish it, put some of that beautiful tomato sauce. And then Again, using stuff up, I normally have a big fat block of Parmesan cheese in my cheese crisp, my cheese container. But I had to buy this for something not that long ago. It's just a shaved Parmesan. So rather than buying a block as well, I'm using this up first. But picture like freshly grated rather than shredded. But it's still going to be delicious. And then some rosemary from my garden. I'm just going to do this to be silly, but kitchen scissors. This is Bridget Jones searching for kitchen scissors. But just to be a bit of a foodie wanker, I'm putting all the garnishes on. Some pepper, a little sprinkle of salt, all right guys, so here it is. Oh, the mousse, I'll let you know what that will be like. I reckon because it's not dark chocolate, I'll probably end up giving the mousse maybe 8. Total foodie wanker. So I've just put on some Parmesan, some shredded Parmesan. The rosemary, I will actually chop it up when I have it for dinner tonight, but I thought that was a nice little posery, stylized piece of meatloaf. And the taste test, I'm going straight for the top because I like the crunchy bits on top. Yep. Lush. 10 out of 10. It is so tasty. I can't tell the difference between having 100% of the same type of beef. If you can buy a kilo of beef at Coles at the moment for $13, then buy it and make this meatloaf. That's so good. You're getting little pops of flavour, but I know that this is going to be even better tomorrow. Like, I always think one day I'll cooking this sort of stuff. It's always better on the second day, but I'm tasting a bit of bacon. I'm tasting a bit of that maple syrup. The actual mince meat itself is really lean and it's got really nice flavour to it. The carrots have offered sweetness, but they're not visible. And the Spanish onion, instead of the brown onion, has worked really well too. It's packed with flavour and it's going to be absolutely beautiful tomorrow. Yum. The recipe for this is in the description, as is the recipe for the super green soup I made earlier with the broccoli, spinach and peas. And the I do need to write up the chocolate mousse recipe, but it was very easy, as you saw. But yeah, this is 10 out of 10. It's fucking amazing. Yum. And I'm going to be delivering portions of it this afternoon to some people I love. I'm going to take your tip, Scout, and use the leftovers to make meatballs. That's a great idea. But I also love meatloaf sandwiches. I've got to go and feed my friend's cats in the morning, so when I'm out, I'm going to go to the bakery and get a freshly baked loaf of bread, and that's what my lunch is going to be tomorrow. I'm going to have a meatloaf sandwich for lunch with some broccoli soup for dinner, or vice versa. No, I'm going to do a meatloaf sandwich, and then I'm going to do the broccoli for dinner. Oh, no, I've also got that bloody cheats paella. Instead of editing this, can you just upload the whole live with your time step? That would be easier. Yes, Scout. Why didn't I do that? Oh my God, I never thought of that. You're a genius. That means I can go back and just time stamp all my earlier ones. What a great idea. Will people do that? Will people read in the description that they can go to the timestamps and see what they want to make? What an awesome idea. Didn't even think of that. That's going to save me a heap of time. Mmm, this is so yummy. I can't stop eating it. So 10 out of 10 for the meatloaf, 10 out of 10 for the soup, and the mousse at the moment, I'm thinking might be more like a, maybe not an 8, maybe a 9. Because that is the easiest chocolate mousse recipe I have ever made. You have got me. That's a great idea. Thank you, Scout. I'm stoked. One day I'll have an editor who'll cut things up and make little videos for me. One day. Maybe this cooking channel will become full-time cooking. And it's not the best kitchen, though. For I mean, I love my kitchen, but it's not great for, like, filming me. Although you don't need to see my face all the time. And I got good feedback on this sort of angle yesterday, so I'm sticking with it for now. But I hope everyone enjoys their Sunday afternoon if you're in Australia. It's nearly 3:30. I'm going to package up some of this food and deliver it. And not before I clean my kitchen. I don't want to leave the site. Why is it saying leave sight? Nope. I don't know where my mouse has gone. Oh, it's over here. I put the recipes over on the bench. But yeah, absolutely divine. And that was so good. And I love that you love the quiche, Scout, and that you make it all the time, because the quiche is an absolute ripper. Shit, 1:20 in the morning, beholder. Well, sweet dreams to you. I thoroughly recommend you do all of those recipes and that cheats paella that I did yesterday. That was really good too. So we've done 4 amazing dishes, but I'm going to start doing the Sunday afternoon wind down, clean up my kitchen, deliver some food, put on the heating and bunker down with Sunny, because tomorrow I'm back to work. So have a great week at work, everyone, especially Australians who head back to work tomorrow. Sweet dreams to everyone who's heading to bed or is up in the middle of the night. Shady Man, you're epic. In and out. In at the start and back at the end. Do you know what I'm picking up so much from this is the maple syrup. I've never put maple syrup in a meatloaf before that I can remember. Like, it hasn't overwhelmed it, but it's just given it. It is quite sweet. Because of the maple syrup and the tomatoes, and so you would like some lemon juice on your beans. I'll put lemon pepper in my mashed potato. Like, I'll do some really hardcore savory flavors with the side dishes. But my God, it's good. If I sleep, I miss your show. Oh, bless you. Hey, there's a lot of people that are in the rewatch replay gang. Thank you, though, everyone, for hanging out with me. I'm going to clean up this mess. I probably will spend a bit of time with Sunny as well. No, that'll be tonight. I think she's snoozing at the moment. But she made a few appearances, which was so cute. I'll timestamp Sunny's appearances too, Scout. but thanks for that suggestion. It's changed my life. And I will do videos from time to time. There are some recipes that are just much easier to do as a video as well. But I'll see you all soon, guys. I'm going to be introducing, we've got batshit, I think, next Wednesday. We've also got to meet our 2 little Tasmanian devil critters. At the moment, it's looking like that's going to be pushed out to later in the week, probably on Thursday. I've got a funeral next weekend and a few things going on. So, yeah, that's going to be pushed out. And then we're also going to start looking into the Brittany Higgins trial. Well, it's not her trial. She hasn't done anything wrong, but someone did wrong to her. So we'll be looking into that as well. And until next time, stay groovy, everyone. But thank you for hanging out. I love your company. I'd be doing this anyway. It just makes it a lot more fun to have people to hang out with. But until next time, stay groovy, everyone. Love you heaps and bon appetit. Happy eating.